on this occasion. We swell with joy and pride to have Professor Dr. Ranbir Singh sir, Professor of Eminence, as a speaker of the day. Professor Dr. Ranbir Singh sir is a founder and former Vice Chancellor of two National Law Schools, National Law School Delhi and Nalsar University at Hyderabad. With over two decades of experience in heading the schools, he carries the aura of a visionary who, as an outstanding statesman and academician, shown immense commitment and contribution towards changing the legal education landscape of the country. Professor Singh's contribution in redesigning legal education in the country has been significant, being a member of the Legal Education Committee of the Bar Council of India. Professor Singh has been the recipient of many awards in recognition of accomplishments, both as an administrator and teacher, researcher, and some of them are. Sir has received Symbiosis AIALS International Association of Law Schools USA Lifetime Achievement Award for Excellence in Legal and Justice Education during the 2017 Global Law Deans Forum. Sir has received Lifetime Achievement Award in recognition of the exemplary contribution towards legal education by Dr. N.M. Viran, Chancellor, Savita University. Karam Yogi Samman, Haryana Institute of Fine Arts by Shri Kuldeep Sharma, Speaker, Haryana Legislative Assembly. Professor Dr. An R. Madhav Menon Best Law Teacher Award in 2011 by Honorable Mr. Justice Altamash Kabir, Judge Supreme Court of India. Lex Witness recognized Sir in the Hall of Fame top 50 as an individual who have helped shape the legal landscape of modern India. Alumnus of distinction at the Golden Jubilee Commemorative Special Convention of Kurukshetra University 2007 by His Excellency Dr. APJ Abul Kalam, former President of India. Excellence Award 1998 Maharshi Dayanand University Rohtak by Governor of Haryana. Educationist of the Year Metrovision Third Annual Media Award 2005. These are the few which I can read, but I have a lot of things which Sir has contributed for making a legal education of this country in a way. The British Council has portrayed him as one of the 12 talented, creative and generous spirits who are making an effort personally and through their institution to ensure their engagement with the UK work to mutual benefit. Sir's service to legal education has been acknowledged and commemorated by many institutions and educational bodies. Sir, we cordially welcome you in our MS. Your presence makes this occasion a very special indeed, because as what I have read, you are the topic which you have chosen to deliver, none other than in India or the world can take this topic, because after reading your bio, we have come to know your contribution, your engagement towards the education and shaping the legal education of India. Now, we now welcome Professor Dr. V.C. Nandan sir, our Vice Chancellor, an inspiring leader, a rare combination of vision, insight, intellect and energy. It is indeed great to have such a person to superhead as us to greater heights, be it scholastic or co-scholastic areas. Your guidance and motivation have really enthused us to scale up our own limits of performance. We welcome you from the abyss of our heart. We also welcome all the faculty members. Your presence and motivation truly counts. And last, but not the least, dear participants, it gives us immense joy to welcome all you participants across the nation through virtual mode. Thank you so much. Over to Ankit sir, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving introduction to our guest and speaker, and also welcoming all the participants. So we have joined through the YouTube also and Cisco WebEx. So after the welcome address, I would like to invite Honorable Vice Chancellor sir to preside over the session and to give opening remarks. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Ankit. Honorable Professor Ranbir Singh, former Vice Chancellor of NLU Delhi and former Vice Chancellor of Nalsar University, former Professor of Rohtak University, dear colleagues of HNLU, students of HNLU, current and past who have joined, other well-wishers and visiting faculty of HNLU who are logged in today to listen to the Foundation Day lecture. I need to connect three things here. One is the university itself, and the second is the speaker, and the third is what is the speaker are going to deliberate to us. I am also in that expectation. The first thing, as I said, Hidayatullah National Law University, as introduced by the registrar, was founded in 2003 as the sixth national law university in the country. And to say, I would say current set of faculty who are leading, except for the new batch of students who joined, I would qualify myself as a junior in trying to get involved with HNLU when I took over as a vice chancellor. So this university, named after a great jurist of India, a only jurist who held three positions as Honorable Chief Justice, as Honorable elected Vice President, and also as a in charge President couple of times. That could be a big news for many who know Honorable Muhammad Hidayatullah as only as a jurist, and who became a Vice President later. He held as the acting President twice, once when he was a Chief Justice itself, due to certain circumstances he was leading. So it is maybe the first university at that point of time to even to name a jurist as part of the university, because others were known from the place generally. And when Justice Muhammad Hidayatullah's name was, you know, suggested and taken up, I think it was welcomed so much by everybody that it was not a partisan thing. It was a unanimous decision when they took his name. And as I said, that for all the people in legal education, there cannot be a better, you know, idol or a icon than Honorable Justice Muhammad Hidayatullah, right? He himself is excellent in his Urdu poetry, and he comes from a kind of a pedigree of an intellect family. So on his name, this university was formed. Very interestingly, this university, when it was formed, it even had, even has now, if you look at the administrative block, a kind of replica of the parliament structure where governance of the country happens. And probably the future people who may govern the country also comes from many of the educational portals. So Hidayatullah National University was basically designed in such an interesting structure. So this is an university which parallelly goes along with the history of a newly created state. The state of Chhattisgarh comes into existence in 2001, and is the first national law university or even a national institute formed post the new state was Hidayatullah National Law University in 2003, within 2 years. So in a sense, the development and the progress and achievement of the state of Chhattisgarh also has a little bit of parallel with a small institute like Hidayatullah National University, among many institutes, also bringing in laurels to the state. So the university itself, people who have visited or yet to visit people whom we'll welcome always, has got an excellent infrastructure and then caters predominantly to the marginalized section, I would call it, where Hidayatullah National Law University, unlike other places in the country, has 32% reservation for scheduled tribe, meeting the objectives of why the state came forward. So in other places, you know, it's 7.5%, it is 32%. That we consider as a great honor. And that is really, really development in my sense of creating a new and strong India. So this is about Hidayatullah National University and you know, its infrastructure and its history in many ways. As I pointed out, the students of HNLU, past out students, have spheres in the traditional field of lawyering, in public policy, in political arena, and even in financial area, in technical area, they've been excellent, contribution by the alumni of HNLU, and that tradition will continue, I hope. This is about that and my colleagues, many of them who are here, who are, I would say that almost, the gap for me with other colleagues is so much. They are a very, very young lot. So that way, one way I feel very rejuvenated. Another way, I need to prove myself to their energy and dynamism quite often. So that is a very interesting factor. The average mean age is much less than the National Law University. And sooner or later, the strength is almost going to double up. And then this school will, I wouldn't say that I did not believe that who is number one, number two, number three, number four. But I would say that what a law school is created with the purpose in a particular space, if it could do that, that's a great thing. Now I come to the speaker of today. When we set this foundation day, then we decided we should have the area about one or two other topics. Then we decided zeroed in on legal education. Then automatically we thought of Professor Ranbir Singh. Professor Ranbir Singh, as the registrar chronologically told you, is, I would state that, in at least if my facts are right, he was the second largest serving head of a university. The first one, as I said, that I'm not an independent archaeologist, but when I Googled out, I found out from Madras University, there was a gentleman called Sir Lakshmana Swami Mudaliar, who served almost 27 years as a vice chancellor. He was basically a honorary vice chancellor who worked for, I think Professor Ranbir could really join now in the screen. I'm thankful for that. So he was there for around 26, 27 years. And then I found Professor Ranbir Singh, 21 years plus, he was there. The point what I want to tell, that when he started Nalsar University, after Bangalore's experiment, after almost a decade, two schools came up. One was Hyderabad Nalsar, and there was the National Law Institute in Bhopal. When these came again, there was a lot of skepticism. Is even Bangalore a kind of a freak success or a freak model happening? Will it be, another schools will be able to do? He successfully steered Nalsar University from its inception until 10 years later when he moved to Delhi to start another new National Law University. And that is the period I was associated with him as a teacher, colleague, you name it. I call him a mentor, a guide, and a friend. So why I want to put that, the great thing which I want to tell, apart from his CV, which is very formal, that there cannot be anyone who doesn't enjoy working with Professor Ranbir Singh. It every day when you do go to the campus or I meet him, it was always full of good ideas. Most importantly, I realized good ideas can spring from people if the leader tries to encourage it and, tells, go ahead with that. So I remember him telling always that don't bother, something is going to really happen, succeed, or something will happen. I am there with you. Please try your best. And that is what we have to do. So always that infectious, smile, what you will have, and then talk. And then, of course, there are a lot of issues, a lot of problems. I now realize as a vice chancellor what it means much, much later. But he was, managing with a great promise, hope, which Nalsar could make a mark of its own. And that was my association with him. And it was not a fluke success, which he replicated again in NLU Delhi, when he moved in. And one thing you would have noticed, whether it's stint at Nalsar or at NLU Delhi, there are cross sections of academicians from all over the country who are ready to bet on him and move with him. And that is what I consider is one of the hallmark of a leader who is sensitive, who is trying to give back. So in that context, we decided it was Professor Ranbir Singh's 20 years of experience. I'm pretty sure that as he was there, he could have spoken in many of the forums, etc. He used to highlight few things. But always they say, when they step back, I'm sure that there are a lot of things which needs to be told. I could not simply guess anybody else who had such kind of close watch on institutions and the processes and the, you know, characters of such legal institutions, which we call total legal education, which will include including people who practice, including honorable judges. I think his interaction must have been the best. I'm pretty sure we thought before he comes out with this successful memoir as a book, we should need a curtain raiser from him. And that is one other reason, means, you know, we can say that we are a smart university without paying him anything on royalty on that count. We thought, you know, what you call us, we'll invite him to share with that. And that is how this title also was discussed. And this title was decided in consultation with him that what is the prediction? Only difference is people sometimes get into this predictions are something which is insurmountable, which is always there. But always predictions are very important if one has to be prepared for the curve. So that is a very crucial part. And we thought that the best thing is to invite Professor Ranbir Singh. He is with us now. So instead of keeping your anxiety, you know, at an arm's length, and instead of me talking, I thought at this particular occasion of this great university, founded on a great jurist name, and who has been doing a tremendous work, he remembers today as a ceremonially a foundation day, and what best it can be, you know, blessed with to have Professor Ranbir Singh amongst us to share his thoughts with us. So with that, I do welcome, along with Registrar, Professor Ranbir Singh, to be part of the discourse today and later for interaction. Now with that, I hand over to the anchor, Dr. Ankit.
Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your valuable time, first of all, for presiding over this session and giving the opening remarks. Though the foundation day, that is in the memory of a date when an institution that is supposed to be incepted, but for our foundation day, when I try to recollect the memories, that again the rebooting which took place in pre-COVID time period when you have joined us. So foundation does not mean always the bricks, but it's all about the values, ethics, culture, which are required to be lived with. We are actually fortunate enough to have Professor Dr. Ranbir Singh, sir. And we are thankful to sir for sparing your time. To all the panelists, to all the attendees, I want to say that total the time Professor will speak would be around 30 minutes. And at the end of around 20 minutes, you can post your queries so that it would be interactive during Q&A session. So should not be a direct questions. It should be from interactive point of view, you can post. And all the attendees, those who have joined us, sir, I would like to inform Professor, sir, and Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir. Sir, we are also connected through YouTube, and other academicians like Dr. Namita Vyas, who is Associate Professor in the School of Law, Oriental University, Indore, and other academicians. I cannot take the name of all due to paucity of time, but we are connected through two platforms, one that is the Cisco WebEx and one that is the YouTube. So through both channels, you can post your queries and I will moderate at the end of the session. Sir, without taking any time, I would like to hand over the screen to you, sir.
Finally, I could be connected. I was really worried that I will not be, because Delhi has got internet issues. Ankit, also let me share with you that the foundation day is also the day when you get a good vice chancellor to establish a university. For me, that is very, very significant, because for you coming of VC Vivekananda to Raipur is also another kind of a foundation day for your great university. Respected Vice Chancellor, I don't know in which definitional sense I define my relationship with you. You have been a younger brother. We have been friends. We have traveled a long journey of right from National Law School, Bangalore to Hyderabad, and we got always connected in different ways. And the esteemed faculty of HNLU, students of HNLU, well-wishers of HNLU, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me immense pleasure to be invited to deliver this Foundation Day lecture of this frontline. As Vivekanand said, after he joined the university suddenly picked up. And it is going with a jet speed, and I'm sure if you hold him back and don't allow him to go somewhere else, the university has got a wonderful, wonderful... one prediction I can make is, as my Foundation Day lecture, that your university is going to go to great heights. The university is the first among the law universities to be named after a great jurist, late Honorable Mr. Justice Hidayatullah, which has established its rightful place in the field of legal education. The Vice Chancellor enumerated the contribution of this great jurist, and I join in saluting the proud son of India. I visited your university for the last first time, in fact, during the valediction of the moot court competition in October 2019. I witnessed in person the energy in the faculty, the energy in the students, and the suddenly after VC Vivekanand joined, the university came to life. The life was there, but you need a leader. This speed of the team is determined by the leader it is led. That has provided you a great leadership, and all the best to you. The title which I chose to speak has created a great maybe curiosity, linking it with legendary Nostradamus, the French philosopher, astronomer, physicist known for his astonishing predictions about world affairs. In the context of the lecture, it is used as an analogy for my thought of what is in store for need in legal education. Such predictions are not meant as a fait accompli, but made with an earnest desire it could be addressed. In such context, it is pertinent to look briefly the past and the present of any prediction. Let me also share with you that we are approaching the new era with 21st century technology, with the 20th century governing processes and 19th century governing structures. So one prediction would be that how what kind of structures we create or the law schools are bound to create so that we enter the 21st century in the real sense. It is often quoted remark that the future is not going to be the same. And we suddenly found in COVID-19, the future was really not the same. One fine morning, we got up and we were told that all of us have to switch over to online learning and teaching. And for us, it was a nightmare for all of us. Nobody knew that we have to switch to online teaching smartly or that swiftly. We used to hear about online teaching in foreign universities universities like, it is to the credit of everybody in India, and especially the law schools, that we very, very swiftly to the online teaching and learning, not only teaching and learning, also the examination process and that. So we could never knew that interface between IT and IT and law. I've been always saying that if somebody will ask me, what is your mandate of a good law school? I would say that we have to produce professionals, those who are technically sound, professionally competent, and socially relevant. And it is to the success of any institution how they produce those kind of graduates. That would be the great thing. We know that the past of the legal education, when the Britishers were here, they were not very serious about the legal education in the country, and they wanted law clerks, not actually lawyers, and the people, those who could afford that kind of education, they went to England for their bar at law, and only Vivekananda used to say very often that many bar at law went behind bars to bring freedom to the country. And if you find, you look around, you will find that the freedom to the country is not only in India but everywhere else has been possible because of the generation of lawyers we had in those countries, and that's how the lawyers had made a very, very significant contribution. So it's a very, very important profession, and that's how the contribution of lawyers cannot be undermined by anybody. And it was only after the emergence of the law schools in, actually the process started in 1986, but the first law school was established in 1988, known as the National Law School of India University, Bangalore. And you might wonder that why it is a school and a university. It has a different story, we'll talk sometime later, that the school and the university was added with the title of National School, Bangalore. Vivekananda might be knowing that. So for 10 long years, friend, there was no other law school. And 1996, I think, there was a meeting of the law ministers in Bhubaneswar. The H.R. Bhardwaj was the law minister at that time. The law ministers of other states were also invited, and the other important legal functionaries. And they took stock of the performance of the National Law School, and they found that it has been a great success. It was decided that let us have a law school in each and every state. And it was in that sequence that the law schools started to be established in other states, like the second came up in Hyderabad in 1998, known as Nalsar University of Law, Hyderabad, of which I had the good fortune to establish. Today, there is almost 25 law schools, including the state universities, which we have. The state universities are kind of universities which affiliate the law colleges within their jurisdiction, but the law universities, we do not affiliate those institutions. So to cut the story short, there was a time when the student, those who will not get admission anywhere else, will come to law. You will find many people coming to lecture you, those who are today Supreme Court judges or High Court judges, saying that how non-seriously law teaching was taken up and law studies were taken up. And then suddenly you find that today there are lakhs and lakhs of students, almost 70,000-80,000 students appear for CLAT, and the almost 25,000 students appear for ILAT for admission. In CLAT there are 2,000 seats. There are only 120 seats. Now the transition have been that initially the students used to come by chance to the legal studies, and now the students come to legal studies by choice. Let me illustrate by saying, a few years back, a girl student from Chennai came to me, and the father was also with the girl and said, "Sir, we want to discuss something with you." I remember the name of the girl, Ranga Shiri. And she said, "Sir, I have a problem." I said, "What is the problem?" "See, that the problem is that I qualified IIT Madras, I qualified Stephens, I qualified CLAT, and I fortunately or unfortunately also qualified Delhi. Now tell me what to do." I said, "No, you are not at the right place. You should find out from peer groups, ask your where you want to go. Take your time, don't be in a hurry." And I said, we can meet after a week." She again came after a week. I found them sitting in the lounge, and I said, "You must have decided that you will not join NLU Delhi." She said, "No, we'll disappoint you." The girl joined me, and when I used to interview students, in the sense I used to meet students and parents. At the time of admission, Vivekananda knows it. We had a tradition of meeting parents and students after every admission. So when she came to me, said, "Why are you joining Delhi?" She said, "My idea is that I want to go in IAS or IFS." And I said, okay, you work hard, you will get it. And this story goes like this. First time she failed in the prelims. Second time she qualified IAS, but she got a very, very low rank, kind of a security service or something. But she very reluctant. She said, no, sir, I'm not going to. I was in constant touch with her. And the day she came to me, I wrote in front of her name, Rangachari IAS. I said, I'm very sure you'll make it. This is what I wrote when you met me on the very first day of admission. That was the prediction by a teacher for a student. And when she appeared the third time, and today she came in IFS, and she is already in Philippines or Taiwan. I think she is in Taiwan. And this is the success story of these places. So that's what I said, that now students join these institutions by not by chance, but by choice. But the biggest challenge is that we have to get the matching faculty. Now, if we don't get the best of faculty for these best of students, then there is going to be a problem. Now, as I said, they are attracting a lot of students. Having given a status report on present, the moot point is, if all is well, what is so going to be in the coming days? Now, the most important transition would be, because of the disruptive technology, we have to prepare ourselves that what is going to be the interface between artificial intelligence and law. Now, it is a time where I remember Vivekananda used to say that it is such a time that when a lawyer sitting in his office may not even have a single book, but can fill up the background of his office with a lot of books because of the technology available today. And those who are in that if you are more interested in the future of legal education, it may not be really true about India, but it is certainly true about other countries. I had a occasion to go to England and to attend an international conference on access to justice, as I was invited by the minister, Mr. Vera, who of the Indian origin. And I had a wonderful opportunity to listen to, I should call him Professor Richard Siskind. He has written three books, very important books, about the future of law and the death of a lawyer. And probably you find a lot of his lectures in YouTube. And this is how he, and you wonder that he wrote a thesis on the artificial intelligence and law in 1980 at Oxford. Now, could you believe that a person could think at that time that how artificial intelligence is going to impact law? People must not have taken him very seriously. But if you see today what he said that at that time. So I think the students of law, the field of law should probably open their YouTubes, if not for anything else, but for listening to lectures of Richard Siskind. He delivered a wonderful lecture of more than 1 hour in Vanderbilt Law School in USA. So notwithstanding the huge surge in enrollment in the law universities, one needs to critically audit what is in store in future. I was privileged and fortunate to have spent 22 years as the founding vice chancellor at Hyderabad and then at Delhi. I submit that with great humility qualifies me to attempt some predictions. I may not be as wise as Nostradamus, but we can certainly look into our future. To propound first prediction, I would like to quote Al Warren, the eminent jurist and former Chief Justice of United States, remarked, "Our system faces no theoretical dilemma, but a single continuous problem, and that is how to apply to ever-changing conditions the never-changing principles of freedom." He said this about judiciary, and the same will fit the legal education. The critique is the pedagogy of the legal institutes are in different world than what the graduate has navigated in practice. In my opinion, such an observation is not far off the mark. If the concern is not met, the current surge towards legal education will fade away faster than it has started in the coming days. It requires a serious rethinking on alternative process. The search for an alternative educational process is best captured by Paul Ferreiro, Brazilian philosopher and educator, in his book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, when he advocated for abandoning the educational goal of deposit making. He wanted it to be replaced by problem-posing education in which the learner reflect on their relations with the world. According to him, deposit making or banking education resists dialogue, treats students as objects, inhibits creativity, and dehumanizes the learner. In the banking approach, the educator role is to fill the student mind with deposit of information that may not be knowledge, that may not be learning actually. In contrast, problem posing education bases itself on creativity and stimulates reflection and action upon reality. Problem posing education enables teachers and students to become subjects of the educational process. In the process, teacher also learns every time. If you see that the more you teach, more wise you think you have become, actually. Subject of education, it sounds, is meant for legal education. The second prediction is that of the analogy of horses and carriage. The horses are the faculty and the carriage is the legal education. Compared to 80s and 90s, it is easy to construct the carriage of legal institutes. But the issue is that of horses which need to make these carriages run to desired destinations. No doubt one does find horses, but are the real ones, the right ones? I'm afraid the answer is no. A glance in many legal institutes will show you hardly there are associate professors, leave alone professors. There are ample applicants, but they will match the aspirants of legal education of the students. Let me remind all of you, and even myself, that the students, those who join these law schools, will come with lot of expectations. And if the rising expectations turn into frustrations, then we are going to have a tough time. So prepare yourself to meet the rising expectations of the students. Otherwise, every law school will face a problem very, very soon, because the students are very, very brilliant. They come with a lot of expectations to these law schools. I'm afraid I'm skeptical on this. This means that this will impact the current upsurge in the coming days, whether this choice of the students, that now the students are leaving medical, they are leaving engineering, and they are leaving many other lucrative professions, are coming to law, maybe because of the multiple career choices, but I do not know whether we do not match the students' brilliance, probably that this upsurge may not be able to sustain. For the second type of aspirants, one require a finishing school to match these standards, probably. And as I mentioned, while prescribing the minimum, as I also believe that the, as far as the faculty is concerned, the salary structure is an essential part of the regulatory regime. The autonomy of the university, what is requisite talent, appropriate, like in foreign countries, the dean of the law school will determine what would be the salary of an assistant professor or an associate professor or a professor, depending on the kind of research he has done or his reputation as a teacher. I'm reminded of the words of Lee Lokaka, the CEO of Chrysler Corporation, who remarked once that in a completely rational society, the best of us would be teachers and the rest of us would have to settle for something else. Foreign countries, the president of America, if he is in a meeting or a dinner or lunch, would come and introduce himself to you. If you are a university professor, say, "I'm Barack Obama. I'm the president of USA. I'm happy to see you." If you are a professor from any of the Ivy League universities, either from Columbia, Stanford, Harvard, or Yale. That is the reputation teachers carry in those countries. The third, the prediction is that the content of future legal education framework, because of the globalization phenomena, one side is a reality with galloping technology revolution. The globalization concept has its cheerleaders and protesters. The truth is that it is neither a harbinger of a new world or a conspiracy of a new kind of a colonialism. It is at its positive and negative impact, which requires a calibrated approach. The nominal sensitization of human rights or climate change issues, gender issues, medical discoveries, cyber networking would not be possible without the juggernaut of globalization. At the same breath, trade imbalance and a cultural hegemony, trafficking in women, children, or digital disparity are impact of globalization. Such polarities require the content of legal education to have both that of universal outlook and national dimension. So the big question which we all of us are going to face, are we ready for the future? All these things which I mentioned, the faculties of today, the law schools of today or tomorrow will have to prepare themselves for what is there in store for them in future. And if they do not have solutions for all these things which are coming up in future, like we face the COVID-19 situation, and law has to find solutions and solve many problems created by COVID-19. We have to be, if we are not future ready, then we are out. The fourth prediction and caution I would espouse is that of emerging senior intelligent and yet insensitive future lawyers. At the risk of being labeled as an conservative all-timer, I make this observation in the last two decades, especially with advent of the national schools. One is witnessing bold and brilliant legal professionals emerging in professions and academia. Yet there are ominous signs that such extraordinary brilliance may not connect with the ordinary people. Are we thinking of the common man in this country? And I often have been saying that when we talk of the preamble of the Constitution of India, we say we the people of India. I often remark, what about we the other people? And there is a when we say we the people of India and we the other people, and I draw your attention to we the other people, there's a huge consciousness of they may be women, they may be children, they may be destitute, they may be disadvantaged, they may be backward classes, scheduled caste, and there is a Krishna used to say there is a fourth world within the third world, and most of these people are invisibles, which are not visible to the naked eye, and the faculties of law, the law schools, the faculties, everybody has to create systems in law where they can see these invisibles, and if these invisibles are not seen by you, then you are definitely in trouble, because this is a very, very serious problem as far as this country is concerned. I remember Dostoevsky said that everybody is responsible to everybody for everything. So please don't think that you are not responsible to those have-nots. And the kind of divide have this in this country, it is really, really a very sad state of affairs. This is where the future lawyer and his character matters. Being smart matters, and being sensitive is a personal choice. Any discourse on character or social role model is considered as impinging upon personal choices. This grounds severe backlash from the stakeholders who have contributed to the system for the professionals to take care of them. So we have to take care of the common man. Swami Vivekananda, one of the visionaries of modern India, rightly said, the ideal of education, all training should be man-making. And if you make robots, and if you don't create human beings, those who are worried about the suffering humanity, rights, those who do not care about the common man, then I do not know what kind of professionals we are preparing. The fourth and the final prediction is to the teachers in the field of legal education. They are a mixed bag of old timers and new timers. The Gurukul spirit of imparting education has been replaced today by accountable and effective deliverables of teaching. The good news is that the creative and energetic aspirants are increasingly seeking legal education. Such aspirants are also diverse in their socioeconomic background. They come from different backgrounds. And if you go to a classroom, you find that they are very bright students, and they are students those who are not that bright, or they come from very, very different backgrounds. In law schools, you remember we student admit students through that idea, which we also support all those students. So we have to be very, very sensitive to that category of students, those who are not so fortunate and they have taken admission in the law schools. This requires not only a compassionate but creative approach. One finds an increasing trend of adversarial approach to the teacher-student relationship. What should have been settled through meaningful dialogue are escalated to win-lose situation. The trend is witnessed in recent times more often than in the past. A reversal of such trend rests primarily with the teaching community and institutional heads. Now, this challenge has to be met by the faculty. You may devote extra time to them. You may encourage them their peer teaching, or the vice chancellor may find ways and means. I remember when me and Vivekan were at Hyderabad, right in the beginning after the admission used to say, if any student is facing any financial problem, they can immediately come and meet the vice chancellor, and there was not a single who got admission in a law school was turned down or was not allowed to join because he or she could not manage financial resources. Now we have to be sensitive to all these things. The education space needs to create an outcome which is waiting to be created in this context. I am reminded of the query posed to Michelangelo, and his response was, somebody asked him, how do you produce statues that are so full of life? He replied, the rough marble already contains these statues. It is a matter of extracting them. If you go to Hyderabad, you find that rock and this inscription at the gate of the administrative and the academy block. I believe in all my students, there is already a lawyer present, and the job of the faculty and the administration is to chisel and bring them out. My best of wishes to all of you. Thank you very much for inviting me for this lecture. I could carry on. This is a kind of a topic where you can carry on and carry on. There are number of issues, but somewhere you have to stop. Thank you very much, Vivekanand, for giving me this opportunity. And we are ready for an open house. I close it here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your time and connecting all the issues which are relevant, whether professionally, technologically, or socially. So, sir, I will post questions to you, which have been given by the faculty members, as well as our own students and alumni and other participants.
Please.
Sir, first question is from Rishi Raj Bhardwaj. He is a research scholar right now in Bennett University. His question is, the course of law has been mostly evolutionary in development rather than revolutionary like technology. Should law and lawyers be proactive or just reactive in reference to recent development in technology?
Both. There's no choice.
Sir, his interconnected question is, what is the impact of artificial intelligence in Indian justice system?
Now, you have seen it now. Most of the courts were functioning online.
Yes, sir.
What greater impact you want in even the Supreme Court, even lower courts, every court suddenly overnight, they have to shift to the, as I said, the shift was so changed, and everybody has to equip themselves for that change. So most of the courts were functioning even at the district court level. But I also acknowledge today that in this country, we have a huge knowledge divide. We have a huge technological divide. and we have a huge demographic divide. These divides are there, but we'll find solution to these. We have no choice but to shift to, and that's why I mentioned Richard Susskind. For that reason, he is of the view that tomorrow the litigation will be ODR, not ADR.
True.
ODR would mean online dispute resolution. Majority of the disputes will be solved on online, and that there will be very little scope for anybody to go to the court of law. And even now, if you go to countries like Canada, Australia, many countries, you don't find anybody there, except judges sitting in a room, in a small room. Everything is online. Everything is online. Yeah.
True, sir. Sir, our faculty member, Dr. Rana, sir, he has a question connected with the overall existence of national law universities. His question is, what is the possibility for national law universities getting the status of Institute of National Importance by the central government for giving a momentum to legal education?
How does that matter? You can excel anywhere. The idea is, I once had a chance, the vice chancellor, they call president of Harvard University, he came to Delhi. And he was meeting the vice chancellor. So one question normally you ask from a person like Professor Larry. I said, Professor Larry, why Harvard is Harvard?
Sure.
So he said three things. First is, we compete like hell. Would compete with Yale and Harvard and Stanford. We compete like hell. And it's a very, yes, very healthy competition. I do not know how many of us really compete in the real sense of the term. Vivekananda is smiling. He knows what competition means. So we don't have that sense of competition between ourselves. And if we don't have that sense, we don't excel. We don't excel. I do not want to, let me tell you, when I came to Delhi in 2008, and the governing council were a lot of high court judges, Supreme Court judges, and Arun Jaitley, Abhishek Manu Singhvi, all these great lawyers were there. School. So how do you create your place within the vicinity of the law schools? And I was very clear that I have to concentrate on research. And I can very proudly say today that as far as NLU Delhi is concerned, we are far ahead in research than the other law schools. The kind of centers we have, the kind of empirical research we started doing, you know that what kind of research Anoop is doing in the death penalty center. Now we named it 39A, or the communication governance center, or all other centers. They are doing a wonderful work, and we do so much of work for the government, and that brings us a lot of good points, and also bring us a lot of money also. So it all depends on you where you want to go. In a law school, we have to be different from a law faculty in a college. It is not preparing your lecture, coming to the classroom, delivering your lecture and going back. No, certainly not. It is just one part of the job we do. If we are not engaged in serious research for the institution and for the state in which you live and for the society, then your work is not done. It is not done, certainly not.
True, sir. Sir, next question is from our LLM scholar, Anushree. Her question is that, in the epoch of digitization and artificial intelligence becoming all pervasive, can there possibly be a prediction that artificial intelligence will replace lawyers?
No, it will certainly not. Human beings will never be replaced, whatever the development may be, but it will certainly facilitate what are you doing. For example, artificial intelligence will tomorrow many same kind of cases you can feed in the computer kind of a data, and it can be decided by the computers. Why you waste your own time when we have 100 cases decided on the same topic? The computer will tell you that what decision should be there. Why unnecessarily waste your time? So it will be to the aid of the human beings, to the aid of the lawyers. It will not replace you. It will facilitate you, your functioning.
True.
So you don't shy away from taking recourse to or taking the help of artificial intelligence. This is the future. It is going to come. You cannot stop it. It cannot stop it.
Yeah. Sir, our first year student there is asking the question that with ever more business seeking to expand their operations across the borders, there is a rising demand for legal professionals with global mindset. In your opinion, sir, what should be the focus of Indian law students to reach the global standards of legal education?
No, it depends what you want to become in life. We have a lot of students from all these law schools. Those who join Magic Circle firms in UK, and they even go to USA. Many have gone for... Now, see, all these years, if you have a look and somebody will do a research, you will find best of professionals in many of the law schools teaching out from India. They have opened their own law firms in USA, and they are in best of law firms in UK. So it depends where you want to go. Now they are going to off late. I see there is a trend that the students are going to civil services, and at least from NLU Delhi, at least 6-7 students every year are going to civil services. They are going to judiciary. They are going to multiple career options now. So it depends what you want to really become. It is all for you to decide what is the future you look for you.
Sir, a lot of questions are there, but due to paucity of time, and I would like to beg for the same one to attendees and participants. So at the last, I will invite Panda sir and Papa Rosa sir. They are the academic conveners of Academic Planning Committee, which has been constituted by Honorable Vice Chancellor sir. So they are pretty much worried in this COVID pandemic time period, and what would be the future and how the things are supposed to be in place. So with your permission, sir, I would like to invite Panda sir first, then Papa Rosa sir.
Oh, sure.
Panda sir, over to you.
Good evening, sir. We are actually very happy to listen to you today this evening for this auspicious occasion of the Foundation Day of SNLU. Probably this is the first time that I am hearing a lecture on this occasion. So we are very much thankful to you and our Vice Chancellor, sir, that he has created this platform. And we had a chance to interact with you in the month of October during the HNMCC. But this time you gave us a very insightful ideas about HNLU, about law schools, about the professionals, about the career prospects in law. So many things that you have added in this lecture. But I still wonder a answer of a question, that why even the best law schools of a country have failed to attract the best of our lots to teaching profession. Could you please, sir, highlight something on this?
That is not the scene today. The things have changed. Now, I'll tell from my own experience that of late, the Indian students, those who are going abroad to Oxford, Cambridge, Yale, Harvard, they have started coming back, and they are teaching, and they are doing whatever research I was mentioning to you at NLU Delhi is all done by majority of the research is done by those two Indian students, those who went abroad and came back and started teaching and doing research. So scene is not that, it's changed. It is changed now. And even our own students, those who did not go abroad, some of them are excellent researchers now, because that culture multiplies, right? When you work with them, that culture multiplies, certainly. So it is all creating a culture of research, certainly.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir.
Anybody? I have all the time.
Sir.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Yeah.
My name is Dr. Papa Rao. Yeah. I had a great opportunity to meet you twice. In 1993, I met you in Andhra University when you came and delivered a lecture. That time I was studying LLM. Okay. Lakshmi Nesar and yourself came to Andhra University and delivered a lecture about the national universities.
Okay.
And second opportunity I got in which I met you during the Vice Chancellor's meeting at Delhi. So where the UGC invited 300 Vice Chancellors from various corners of the country to deal with good governance. So I was participated in that one session. You chaired. I was there that time.
Okay.
In 2010. So that is a great opportunity for me to interact with you, sir. So now my concern is that regarding the legal education. So as far as the rural areas concerned, as far as the traditional universities concerned, the legal education is not up to the mark of the national university with regard to the moot courts and internships. So they are very much concentrated on the judiciary. And when they want to come and practice in the courts and all these things, so there are certain barriers with regard to the moot courts, with regard to analyzation, with regard to all factors. So the Bar Council also giving lot of colleges without any infrastructure, without sufficient faculty, all these things, sir. So how long this system will go, sir? So I don't understand what measures the legal education system will adopt to bring the rural law colleges, law universities part with the national language, sir. Please, sir, throw some light, sir.
Very simple. In our days, we used to have very few engineering colleges, right? And few medical colleges. And today we see that mushrooming of the engineering colleges, mushrooming of the medical colleges, and also colleges in other fields of other disciplines. Let me tell you, the best will survive, the worst will perish, right? And because this is the age of competition, why students should go to a third-rate engineering college or a law college or a medical college and see how many medical colleges have been closed, how many engineering colleges have been closed, how many colleges of education have been closed, because even pharmacy have been closed. Because you do not require that many colleges, and if you don't have faculty to teach in those, and there is no idea of, and that they will not survive. I remember suddenly I was in the legal education committee of the Bar Council of India. Suddenly there were a lot of requests for opening of the law colleges from Gujarat and Punjab. And I said, why suddenly so many requests have come? And then we found that all those engineering colleges which were closed, they opened because they are best of buildings, and they suddenly opened law colleges. Because in law colleges, you do not require that much of infrastructure. You just require buildings and classrooms and other facilities. So that's how now people are shifting to law. And you will see very soon, that prediction at least I can make very surely, Vivekanand, that another 5-10 years, you will see 15-20% law colleges would be closed. And also let me make a prediction, Vivekanand, that out of the 25 law schools, there will be only 10-15 which will be law schools in the real sense of the term. Otherwise, rest of them would be glorified law colleges. If you do not do serious quality research, you are not more than a glorified law college. So it depends on you whether you want to be called a glorified law college or a law university. Because the expectations of people from a law university, of the students, parents, and the society is very, very different. So you are sitting on a razor edge. And if you do not upgrade yourself, then either you perform, you perish, or you perish.
Thank you so much, sir.
My viewers.
Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your time, and especially sparing time for this interactive session. I'm sure all of the attendees have benefited from your enough experience in this particular field, and the prediction which you have made, it includes a caution also regarding the relevancy, what we have to do, what we don't have to do to be competitive as well as to be in existence. So, sir, on this note, I would like to invite Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, for giving closing remarks. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Ankit.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ankit. And so, as I said, that as we move to a huge technology, revolution, not out of design, out of default of this pandemic. And this was possible today to get a professor from, Gurgaon to speak here with us, and many of you are connected. At the same time, they said that we are scaling up And so it had its own initial hiccups. And we are glad that Professor could join, you know, on camera with us, and his own candid style could put across what is happening. As you said, this topic, what he dealt, an analogy of Nostradamus. Often Nostradamus is said some mysterious way he has predicted hundreds of years back. So we just took the famous name as an analogy so that he could tell us, but his things are not predicted out of some clairvoyance, but it's out of experience, out of thinking, out of, you know, going through, I would call it as various turbulences of running law schools, at the same time, you know, also tasting a lot of success through certain clear goals. So he did, as I said, it's a very vast thing, could qualify for a book, right? But I would say that he put it at least a few crucial areas where he said, end of the day, that the bringing of law schools, especially, not that there were no legal education earlier, it had a glorified tradition. Somewhere it slipped down, neglected, you can call it, or it was, I would call it as neglected or liquidated or whatever you call it. Then there was a revival with the advent of the national law universities, and that has rubbed off everywhere. I would even say that as part of a founding dean of a private law university, and many law universities are doing a very serious business. And that's a happy thing, whether you are public or a private university. But nevertheless, national law universities suddenly brought the burst what is required about the rightful place of law, legal education in the pantheon of different, you know, sectors. That way he acknowledged the past as well as he categorically made very few points. I call it as warning shots, that these could be reversed. It is not a prediction which means which will happen come what may. But he said, if you don't do these things, these predictions will come true or it could be reversed. There he touched upon excellently about that faculty, especially to really match up to the rising expectation of students. As we said, with the information age is almost over. Everybody has more information, you know, thanks to internet and other things. So what do they expect from a teacher? Not merely information processing in a classroom, but rather certain intuitive things which will make them, you know, a people of, you know, taking issues that he touched upon. Second, he did touch upon very clearly about what type of education. He talked about critical thinking and problem posing education that he spoke. Then he went on to talk about especially about research areas, where he gave his own example of NLU Delhi doing a wonderful research in the last one decade, where the focus came. Of course, NLU Delhi does have a great locational advantage, but that doesn't mean the other people, if you really look at it, at least matching research should be done in different places. Seems to be there is no imagination in that area. That's all I would tell. Enthusiasm is one thing. Putting the imagination into the rightful perspective, that he very, very clearly undermined how a new law university within a matter of 10, 11 years could, you know, produce certain voluminous thing. As I often visit NLU Delhi, I was wondering whether NLU Delhi is an educational institute or a conference hub, because every alternate week when I go touch upon that place, there will be some major deliberation happening there. So that certainly, what you call us, puts us ideas for others to really put it across and do. That was a excellent thing what he tried to underline. And third, most importantly, he was connecting that how you are smart, but are you sensitive, was a big question. What happened? Is a legal profession is something, a passport or a visa for a great good life of some very good money and fast cars. But he said that is not the purpose of legal education, because as much a patient with a health issue is standing with folded hands in front of a doctor, right? Similarly, they are standing with a hope of justice in front of that. And so he touched upon those social issues about the divides, what is happening, which is a reality. And so the bottom line, what he said is that it's a brave new world where legal education should move in. And if it doesn't get put its act together in certain things, that is where I thought his predictions were, you know, listed, not as something which will happen come what may. But he said, because one way I would put it, in his own lifetime of 20 odd years as vice chancellor, I'm pretty sure that he had turned around things. If he could put Nalsar from from a place where almost people did not understand. When I joined Nalsar also 20 years back, somebody I said, Nalsar, they said, what is the pin code? They asked me. They thought it's a place and it needs a pin code, right? That was the kind of thing. So I need to explain to them, no, it's a law university. And then, so that was, I'm talking 2000, you know, when just we are 1 year old, and then he did that. As I said, one thing, learning thing from me as a person now having a small stint here to do is, certainly I owe something to Professor Ranbir Singh. Because I remember in our interaction, and people often think that I am the blue-eyed, you know, faculty of Professor Ranbir, and there has to be a rumor, whatever Vivekanand says, he will sign. Let me tell the secret, it's not true. We have had heated arguments in his room. Only thing, the argument will end because he will finally smile and order a nice cup of tea for me. And he will tell, cool down. And sometimes he will tell, when you sit in my position, you will understand certain things, how difficult to move forward, even though you have some, you know, valid points, he used to tell. So these are all big learning curve where he had one philosophy always, which I don't know whether he does that. He does tell that. I don't know. I do recollect. He will tell, the most sensitive creatures in the world are teachers. He says they are teachers. You tell, even if you deny him the housing quarter, he will keep quiet. But if you are going to tell that he's not doing well, that's it, he said. So he used to always, you know, what you call as put the brave front, tell people to encourage. He was not never in pointing out mistakes, but rather he will say, come, what should I do? What can I help and put it? Was one thing which in my early experience as a teacher working with him, this has been ingrained in me in a sense. If I do practice that in other places where I went in small stints and currently with you, I would say that this as it all, we imbibe things everywhere. And so I imbibed all these things from him, that about the dignity of teachers, you know, and how teachers have to be, you know, encouraged tremendously, which will work miracles, is something which I, at least 10, 12 years of directly working with him. And later on also I used to interact. I'm sure when people from different people, even people who retired, flocked to NLU Delhi. I remember many good teachers from different parts came to NLU Delhi. I would say that he was a magnetic force to attract all of them together. And so that way I would say that NLU Delhi, not only locational advantage, it had the great advantage of Professor Ranbir Singh being there, is one important thing. And all the more puts the pressure for me or Professor Krishnadevarao or anyone to not to just to match, it's not possible to match, but at least we can carry on the legacy, or we can carry on some of the things which he was passionate about as a teacher, as an administrator, what he did. So in fact, I was planning after his retirement to have a kind of a small event in campus to bring him in. I'm sure that will happen much later when we start, you know, getting into a certain level of normalcy and moving in. But I could not resist the temptation to get him online. And I'm pretty sure at Professor Ranbir Singh at 71, I presume 70 or 71, he still looks to me 10, 15 years younger, right? Or rather, who had seen me with him when I was 20 years back, they will think I am aged much faster. So, but he could easily sit in his residence and then try this, you know, internet, which did not come in the beginning. I was very tensed actually, whether it could come only on audio. If he could boldly deal with technology, and if he could, you know, what you call as smilingly welcome the interface of technology and law, and at the same time, he beautifully answered whether we have to embrace, whether we have to be, you know, he said that we are not slaves of technology. That technology is what aids us. And when typewriters were removed and computers came, people thought typists will go away. But computer, you know, the DTP operators came in. So even whatever may be the artificial intelligence or technology, it's end of the day, it is the humans, lawyers. So tomorrow you'll have lawyers who are writing codes, lawyers who are writing softwares, lawyers will be dealing that. That element will always be there. As you said, this is an era of a fast technology. Technology has been always with us in one or other form. Now it looks like a little mind-boggling. But as I said, at the end of the day, technology is also a product of human beings. And so lawyers, he tried to tell that means, you know, you need to negotiate. Or I would like to close what the saying of the Robert Kennedy's father said, that when things get tough, the tough get going.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that is, I would take it as a message from Professor Ranbir. So I will finish my closing remarks at this point, being a very happy person, you know, joining on this Foundation Day along with somebody whom I admire.
Thank you. Thank you, Vic. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for very beautifully giving the closing remark. Sir, our faculty members, Dr. Inos Samal, sir, Dr. Balwinder Kaur, ma'am, and other faculties and students would were willing to interact with you, frankly, but due to paucity of time, that is not possible. But Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, has given this particular idea that when the things will be normal, we will have again the opportunity to have you with us. So thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time.
Come to Raipur.
Yes, sir, yes. So with the permission of Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, sir, I am going to invite Mr. Jeevan Sagar, sir, to propose formal vote of thanks, sir.
Okay. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor, and our invited speaker of the day, Professor Singh, respected Registrar, Dr. Deepak, learned gathering of faculty fraternity, dear audience from across HNLU and other reputed institutes, my evening greetings to one and all present here, virtually present here. And HNLU has given me yet another privilege today to stand here to express the note of gratitude. In the foremost place, I thank our Vice Chancellor, Professor V.C. Vivekanandan, sir, for having an ambitious vision for HNLU to become a front runner in the realm of legal education. You have been
Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor V.C. Vivekanandan, our invited speaker of the day, Professor Dr. Ranbir Singh, respected Registrar in Charge, Dr. Deepak Srivastava, learned gathering of faculty fraternity, dear audience from across HNLU and other reputed institutes, my evening greetings to one and all present here virtually. HNLU has given me yet another privilege today to stand here to express the note of gratitude. In the foremost place, I thank our Vice Chancellor for having an ambitious vision for HNLU to become a front runner in the realm of legal education. You have been bringing in such noteworthy legal mavens to HNLU ever since your joining, sir. Consequently, we have been the witness and participant of that metamorphosis. I would never have it would never have happened unless Professor Ranbir Singh had that love for HNLU. Sir, your thoughts on legal education in India, a Nostradamic perspective, have indeed opened new horizons of divergent thinking in us. Today, I realize why you are called the Vice Chancellor of the Vice Chancellors. We are much obliged to have you amidst us, and we promise you that we would live up to this prophecy that you have made for HNLU, that it is going to be one of the front runner in the realm of legal education. I thank all the faculty members who have made it a priority to join this program. And I would like to thank the participants as well. My special gratitude to Digital at HNLU and IT team and Pawan Khatri for the smooth run of this program. I would also like to thank SEC Online and EBC for being our knowledge partner, and Live Law for being our media partner. And I thank everybody for being the part of this great occasion. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you again, once again. And I hope to interact with you more often. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. With the permission of Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, I am going to close the session, and I will forward the feedback links to all the attendees. Thank you all.